you guys. Welcome to another edition of Curtis Collects Vinyl Records. It's a special edition. We're going to call this an equipment review. I've got a lot of questions about my system here, so I thought I would try to explain a little bit how I've acquired the assembled the equipment and what it is. I don't know all the specs and output on things. I should know a little bit more about what I've got here. For instance, you guys are going to ask about the stylus. Not even sure what that is. Okay, so we're going to leave James Taylor on in the background. I also get a lot of questions about these stands that my dad built. So up top, we'll start right here. This is a about a 3 or 4 year old project expression. It's a notch above their debut 3, and I really like it. I play most of my records here if I'm just going to play one record at a time. I just like the mechanics of it. I bought it as a floor model, so I didn't pay full price for it. It was not technically used, but it was their demo version that they had on the showroom floor at Music Direct. Shout out to those guys in Chicago with Bess. He's great. So what else do we have here? So I went to a DJ store. I was having problems with my my receiver, my power plant, and it was overheating because when we play loud records here with a lot of people, I've got some massive speakers, and I was overdrawing and overpowering the ability of my receiver to power these speakers, and this was getting just really hot here. I had a Yamaha receiver. The reason I bought this, I got it from a DJ store. These are fans here, and I can play this all week loud, and this stays just really, really cool to the touch. And it's pretty straightforward here. This is just channel A and channel B. I like the fact it has this little locking switch here. I think if you're a DJ, you can lock it. No one can mess around with the settings. So it looks kind of like a little ignition switch. It's really not that at all. And I'll take the camera off now and give you guys a review of the rest of the stuff. All right, guys, well, we're going to go handheld now. All right, well, we might as well show you the rest of the record room here. Here's my record table with cleaning, my cleaning device there that I use a lot. I go through a lot of that fluid. It's called the Spin Clean. So we like that. Back over here, this used to be a workshop. It still is. I might have 80 crates available here. Starting with the A's. I think you guys have seen some of these. Down around there. My jazz collection is down below there. The Rolling Stones record you see, that's about 120 EPs, long playing singles. Here are some random miscellaneous crates. My country and western lives underneath my B turntable. All right, I'm going to try to turn the volume down here on this a little bit. Okay, maybe that's better. All right, so we've covered turntable A, the power plant here, and we'll come over here. This is a 10-year-old, probably a $60 Radio Shack 4-channel. Mixer fader, which I just love. It was inexpensive and it's great. So I can come. I've got a volume fader for a DJ mic if somebody wants to do karaoke. Here's my A channel. I can slide it over here to get over to the Rega. This is an isolated volume on A. Here's isolated phono B. In case I do want to play a CD, don't laugh. I do once in a while. Here we have that, and then here's my master volume control. Whoopsie. Other settings here. Okay, what do we have down here? This is just a standard issue Sony 5-disc tray automatic disc loading system. And it's probably 20 years old. Works fine. Okay, I always like to show this one off with a Who record on it. So, this is the Riga RP1. And as you can see, it's in that very sweet, very cool looking Union Jack motif. So that is really cool. And then I'll try to give you guys a little show of these little stands that my dad built. So they are 3/4 inch plywood. And it's threaded rod and tube construction for the vertical posts. So the other thing we did to make it kind of look nice is we took a router and kind of eased this edge down here with an OG bit. And here's really the main stanchion here. This is threaded rod inside this tubing, and then you just cap it off. So it's coming all the way from the bottom here, and it's like compressing the top to the bottom. They're really solid. You can find these, but if you've got a minimum amount of tools and skills, you can build these. The other thing, I was having a lot of problems. I was having some hum based on the power that my amp and preamp was throwing. I put these rubber dampeners here and a dampening sheet, and I also have a dampening pad there, because this the fan motors was leaking into the cartridge and being picked up by the speakers. So I pretty much eliminated that. So hope this covers everything. I think it's called an Otaphone stylus or cartridge head over here on the project. All right, guys. Thank you, baby. Let me set this back down. How timing couldn't have been better. So we had a three-song James Taylor medley as the bed, as they say. And then, oh, I forgot to talk about my speakers. These are called Gem Sound. I'm not sure if it's in the picture. Yeah, how can I forget the speakers? And darn it. And then underneath the TV in the back, I've got another monster pair of floor-standing speakers that were custom-made by, I think, an outfit called Chicago Audio. Or Chicago Soundworks, and my good buddy Radio Dave, who's been on the radio for many, many years as a DJ, gave them to me, and they're great. So, this was an equipment overview edition, special edition of Curtis Collects Vinyl Records. Have a great holiday season, and thanks again for watching. We'll see you back here again soon.